Welcome to Return to Beacon Hills, a Teen Wolf Rewatch podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Will Wallace. Every week we watch and talk about the hit MTV series one episode at a time, but this week we're bringing you an interview with Melissa Ponzio that we recorded at Howler Con 2022 in New Jersey. We also got to talk to a handful of fans and other actors, so make sure to stay to the very end to hear all of that. If you'd like to support the show, you can find us on Patreon at RTBH Podcast. There, our Wolfie patrons will gain access to awesome exclusives like early access to episodes, Full Moon AMAs, the Beacon Hills Movie Club, where we watch and provide commentary for movies starring the amazing cast of Teen Wolf and featuring the work of our talented crew, as well as guest video interviews and a monthly watch party. So head on over to patreon.com/RTBH podcast and join the pack. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at RTBH Podcast and Tumblr and TikTok at Return to Beacon Hills. If you'd like to ask us questions or offer suggestions for future topics to discuss, you can email us at returntobeaconhills@gmail.com. All right, Wolfies, now we're going to jump over to our interview with Melissa Ponzio at Howler Con 2022. Who's ready to talk about Teen Wolf with the wonderful Melissa Ponzio?
Yay! Awesome. We made it!
Welcome to the very first live episode of Return to Beacon Hills. For those unfamiliar with us, we have a Teen Wolf Rewatch podcast that you can listen to on Spotify, Apple, Google, Audible, pretty much anywhere you listen to podcasts. Subscribe, please. Thank you. My name is Will Wallace, and I was a writer on Teen Wolf. I wrote 5 episodes, and it was the greatest job I've ever had, no lie at all. And it's also how I met 2 of my very best friends and co-hosts. Got one right here, and we got a digital version of one right here. Last year, I was very lucky and I got to work with Jeff Davis, Joe Janier, and Russell McKay to shape the story for the upcoming Teen Wolf movie, though there have been some significant changes since I was there, so we're all going to have some fun surprises while watching it, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah. So, my name is Melissa Mullis, and yeah, I met Will through a fan run convention in 2014, so this is kind of coming full circle here, that we get to come back at another convention and talk about Teen Wolf. And unfortunately, Kate was unable to make it, but we do have, well, not her physical form.
Her digital form.
She's a digital form, yeah. So let's hope technology is on our side with that one.
Yes. Yes.
And then, yes, we're very honored to be joined by the lovely Melissa Ponzio.
Yay! Thanks, you guys. Thanks for being here.
Once again, gracious enough to talk to us about all things Teen Wolf, because she's already been in one episode of our podcast, and it was one of the best episodes we've done.
Aww. I love it when you lie. I love it.
It was a lie. It's the best.
No. Episode. Stop.
So, yeah.
Keep going.
All right.
Like Barbara right up there.
Barbara's amazing.
Barbara had some stories to tell.
Yeah. No, Barbara will tell it. Yeah. She's one of my favorites.
Melissa, yes. You've attended all the past Howler Cons.
Yes. So, haven't missed a one.
So, and this is apparently the last one.
So she says. Yeah, I actually posted some. I was, you know, going through all the images on my phone, and we were here back in 2017, and it seems like it was yesterday. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun for everybody to be here. I'm happy to see all your faces. It's going to be a really great weekend. We're really excited about the movie. It was really wonderful to kind of get back together and it just be like, I know this sounds so corny, but, you know, get the family back together. It really was amazing. And we had some, well, I guess we'll get into it. I don't want to, sorry.
No worry. No.
She just goes like a freight train.
It's all great.
We love it.
All great.
So, okay, no, please.
We're going to win.
We have some questions. So okay. We're going to try to weasel some
all right, weasel.
News out of you.
Let's do yes. it.
Okay. So what was it like getting that first call that Teen Wolf was greenlit for an official movie?
Well, it was really out of the blue and surprising, and one of the happiest phone calls I think that we could all get, because, you know, not everybody, as you know, with all the different shows that you watch, not everybody gets a you know, another bite at the apple, so to speak. So I think that we were all really thrilled, and you know, it's that double-edged sword of not only are we thrilled to be back to work at a project that we all really love, but we all get to be back together. I mean, you know, they got the band back together, you guys, most of us. So that was really wonderful. And as I was talking with Will, some of us had the opportunity actually to shoot out in Los Angeles as well as Atlanta. And that was really like crazy, because here you are literally on the stages that, you know, you left so many years ago, and it's like nothing has changed. So for those that were able to be out in Los Angeles, we were able to see some of the crew that couldn't make it to Atlanta. And so literally it was like a coming home experience. And then we came over to Atlanta, and Atlanta's great. Have you guys ever been to Atlanta? No? It's a great town. I mean, I live there, so I'm going to tell you that it's great. But it was really great to shoot there. You know, we did stuff on stages and on location, and that was a lot of fun too. And just I don't want to say that it was effortless, because it takes hundreds of people in order for us to show up and have a real fun party on set, but it seemed pretty effortless. And yeah. And good writing, Will. Good writing, Will.
It was mostly me.
It was.
No matter what Jeff says, this guy right here.
Kate and I, like, texting him ideas. Yeah. Like, hey, like, Will, wouldn't it be really funny if they say this? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, block.
Say, new job, who dis? So. Teen Wolf has always meant a lot to its devoted fans. What do you think the return of Teen Wolf will mean to these fans that have stuck with the show all these years, even after the show ended?
Well, I guess we'd have to actually ask the fans. But I would hope that it was well worth the wait. I hope that you find the same level of creativity and mastery in everyone's department. I hope you find some really interesting new surprises. You know, I get a lot of people coming and saying, hey, you know, I watched this when I was a kid, whatever that means. And now I'm watching it with my, you know, younger sister or younger brother. I turned a friend onto it, and I'm finding the show again. And so I hope that, you know, we were able to take all those elements of the show and now create a completely different medium. Because as we were talking before, you know, to shoot a TV show and to shoot a movie, completely different experiences. Or I could say for myself, it was a completely different experience. I mean, yeah, you're sitting there and you're telling the same story, but just the way that you go about it is different. And so that was a lot of fun for us as well. You know, and there's always special effects.
Yes.
Special effects and fighting and blood. So who doesn't love that?
No one.
No one.
That is the answer.
Working on the movie, did you get a chance to work with any actors that you didn't really get to share that much screen time with during the original run of the show, such as Malia or Dr. Deaton?
Yes.
Derek, I'd like to add, we realized when going back through, like, you know, you don't get any scenes with Tyler Hoechlin.
That's right.
I feel like that's just a really missed opportunity.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I want to also say, like, maybe in the fifth season or sixth season when we were having our, like, little convo of what would you like to happen with your character, which is always a wonderful thing. That was the first time ever that anyone had asked my opinion about anything. So I gave it to them, and it was like, it's really great to work with people that we haven't before. You know, I mean, I'd love to work with you know, Shelley Moore. Shelley is so fun and fantastic and lovely, and I would have to say, and we talked about this actually, Seth and I, I don't think it's a spoiler that we have scenes together this time, and that was a lot of fun. You know, we had a couple of storylines within the show, but Seth is just a really great dude. He's so peaceful, and our ships kind of passed on Walking Dead, and so we didn't really get a chance to work together on that. And so just to have a couple of scenes this time around was a lot of fun, a lot of fun. That's and I think everybody has that enjoyment, mm-hmm. you know.
Absolutely,
mm-hmm.
absolutely.
Do you feel like the film will be accessible to people who've never watched the show before? Like, they're just scrolling through Paramount Plus and see it and started, do you think that it'll just be completely lost, or?
No, I hope so. I mean, I think you guys did a really great job of weaving a new story. You know, you took the elements of what we had, and you have something new, and it's encapsulated, and it's right there, and it's very attention-getting, and there's a thread line all the way through it. And so from start to finish, I think someone could pick it up and watch it. And then I think start to finish, someone who's watched it for a very long time will find all those beautiful touchstones. There's a lot of fun in this one. So, you know, some of those times where, you know, where maybe the seasons were a little darker, right? Like the Dread Doctors for me. You remember, I mean, I think it was in season 4 when we had that guy like pulling his teeth out. Do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
I was like, dude, where are we going? Where are we going with this dentistry? But I think there's more levity, you know, and I don't know if that's because the medium is different. I mean, what would you say? I'm going to throw this one to Will.
Oh, wow. I don't know, because like when we were breaking the story way back in October, mm-hmm. it didn't feel like a different medium. It didn't feel like we were telling a different story, because no. Teen Wolf has always been big and epic,
right.
You know? So just because we're not doing a movie, it's like, well, we're just going to be big and epic. We know exactly what we're doing. And the one thing Jeff did say is we don't have to worry about time. So, you know, because the TV show was 42 and a half minutes. Like, that's all the story you get. And now it's just like, I don't know, what do we need for the story? If we need three scenes to do this thing, then we do it in three scenes instead of the old way, which was you get a line of dialogue to
right.
do all this.
He went that away.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So to me, as we were working on it, it felt just like a big, it felt just like a big episode. Like, it felt just like a natural continuation of the story and with the characters. And just because it's a movie in quotes, because it's going to be on Paramount Plus, it didn't feel different. It just felt like, oh, we get to do the same thing again, and it's so much fun.
Well, maybe it's to the point what I was telling you before, like, you know, to shoot again, just to shoot a television show and movie feels different. So maybe that's where my experience comes from.
Right.
Or maybe, and also to the tune of it being funny, maybe we just read it funny. Maybe it wasn't supposed to be funny, and now it is.
Yeah.
Because nobody corrected us, okay? Shelley's very funny. She, you know, I touched on to her again. You know, maybe we were just delivering it in a different way, and that'll be fun. I mean, I think, you know, there, with the darkness, there must be light. So
exactly.
Thanks. I'm actually going to bring a question on you, Will.
Sure.
I know you have looked at the completed script, even though, like, you know, it has changed mm-hmm. a lot. How long is it? Because you said it was long.
Yeah, it was
140 pages. 170 pages?
No, it wasn't that long. It was
290 pages.
There it is. There
That's
it is.
It.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Y'all can print that. It's 100% true. Don't print that, please. No, it was like 125, 130. It was, and I read The White. So who knows what happened mm-hmm. after that. When you're making TV and a movie, at some point the writer is working on it the entire time, and then at some point they say, okay, right now this is the white draft of the script, and they lock it. And then everything else that happens after that is revision. It's all revisions and stuff like that. So you'll see a script. You can find a script that's like, why is this script 153 pages? But then you flip through it, and it's only a half page or a quarter page and stuff like that. And that's just due to revision. So who knows what y'all got, but the white version I had, I think, was like 125 or mm-hmm. 130. Mm-hmm. So I was excited, though. I was like, there's so much in here. It's
totally,
so great. So,
totally.
Yeah.
I'll ask him questions occasionally, and he'll be like, I can't tell you that. You
it's a lot
of fun. Right? And I'm like, no, I want to know now.
Well, too bad.
He's not into that. So.
Now, there has to be some surprise. There has to be something. You know, it's going to be the Teen Wolf movie. Everybody has to go into it and be like, what?
I don't know if I'm emotionally prepared for that, though, Will.
Too bad.
It's a lot.
That's the answer to that. We've heard that, you know, the Teen Wolf show ended 2013-ish.
Mm.
As far as the timeline, we're going to call it a timeline, is concerned. It's a bit wonky. It's all over the place. But we know that the movie takes place about a little ways out there. What do you think Melissa's been up to in all that time?
I think, you know, she's been spending so much more time at the hospital. As we know, she runs that joint, you know. I think that she's probably been learning to, you know, let go of her son a little bit, mm-hmm. let him have his independence, mm-hmm. you know. That is a natural progression as we all age and, you know, we become ourselves. I think she's also been putting the pedal to the metal for her professionally. You know, there's some changes there. And it was really great to be back in the house. I got to tell you, I mean, just personally, you know, because, I mean, we spent a lot of time shooting the show. You know, we spent a lot of time in that house. And that house is a, even though it's a set, it's a real place for all of us. And so when I got the opportunity to go out to Los Angeles and walk in, it was literally like, well, everybody kept saying, this is like a fever dream. Like, this is so strange that we're all back here working again together. But it really was a really... You know, not everybody gets this opportunity to go back, so we're all very excited.
Kind of make me tear up.
Aww. I keep repeating myself, but
that's
I mean it. That's
fine. That's okay.
I was rewatching the series finale, and you get some pretty badass moments there.
Yeah.
Do you think that Melissa was training with Chris Argent during the time, and we maybe get some more fight scenes or anything?
I got to hand it to Jeff. You know, one of the things, forgive me if you already know the story, but when I was approached to do Teen Wolf, first off, I was not the first choice.
Shocking.
But that's okay.
Really?
Best choice.
Best choice.
Best choice.
No, but it was, and so I remember my manager at the time, he was like, well, you know, it's going to be shooting in Atlanta. Atlanta's home for you. It's going to be great, because I was in Los Angeles at the time. And he was like, and listen, you know, they've got the parents, but then it might be only 3 or 4 episodes, and then they're going to write the parents out a la Vampire Diaries. And I think one of the smartest things that Jeff ever did was open the parents to what was going on and really making the parents part of the show. Because, you know, when you're watching these shows and you got all these kids running around, like, you know, running the world. I mean, it's really great to suspend belief, but I mean, I think that kind of just grounds us a little bit more, you know, in where we are. And you know, and for Jeff to bring everybody in actor-wise to do different things, you know, he never really pigeon-toed, I think, anyone to just be in this one particular mold. And, you know, Melissa McCall is a nurse, so you only see her in the hospital. No, you see her in the forest, and you see her maybe picking up a weapon, and you see her trying to do something on the side that might be a little bit more holistic, that's, you know, not her normal training. And so he has really allowed at least this character to branch out. And, you know, I think we're all forever grateful for all the opportunities. And when you're on any show, you know, when an actor looks back, it's like, wow, I've been shot to death. And I was married, you know, and I had a baby, and, you know, and personal loss, and, you know, and personal gain, and all these things. And that's why most of us choose this career, is because, you know, we want to be somebody different, doing a different experience every time that we show up. And, you know, and Teen Wolf has allowed that, even within the parameters of our characters, to kind of branch out. Did I answer the question?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to make sure, because I'll just keep rambling for a
yes.
while.
And I completely agree. I feel like what really made the show, like the family feel real, is the fact that they didn't write out the parents, like, you know, became involved. And, you know, Scott, I've commented on this before, but Scott's wearing like Target clothes, which makes sense for like a working single mom and stuff, instead of like a $300 jacket and stuff, which just seems like, where are these kids getting their money? Jackson, maybe, but
yeah,
like,
right.
It doesn't make any sense on these other teen shows where the parents just are gone for like just 9 months out of the year. They're just disappeared. And then, yeah, they're wearing like $1,000 clothes. It just doesn't make sense. But Teen Wolf felt very, very real, which was a great contrast to the werewolves on the show.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll give it up to Barbara for that, you know?
Yeah.
There was even one scene where I wore a shirt that was one of Scott's shirts. And she's like, that makes sense.
Yeah.
You're a mom who's a nurse. We don't have a lot of money. You know what I mean? You would probably would be wearing your, you know, your child's hand-me-downs. My mom wore my stuff. It makes complete sense, you know?
You touched on this a little bit. We actually wanted to ask about the parents, because that was something that really set Teen Wolf apart from something like The Vampire Diaries or The Secret Circle. Can you tell us anything about the role of the parents in the movie?
No. other than to say that they are involved, and, you know, that speaks volumes again to the choices that you know, the creators and the writers make. We are very involved in the movie, and it makes it that much more, I think, layered. You know, it's fun to see the adult perspective when with kids, and vice versa, I think, and it there's a certain amount of tension that plays there in a way. And also, you know, lessons learned, and you know, I think it's a symbiotic relationship between, you know, a parent and the child. You're constantly learning from one another, and I hope you see that in the movie. If not, just tell me so.
The movie has a lot of familiar faces, including you, Tyler Hoechlin, Colton Haynes, Ian Bowen, J.R. Bourne, Ryan Kelly, and Lyndon Ashby, all of whom are also at Howler Con this year.
Yay!
Cool.
Yeah.
The movie has some new faces too, like Vince Mattis, Amy L. Workman, and Nobi Nakanishi. Did you get a chance to work with any of them on the movie? And what was it like bringing them into the fold of Teen Wolf?
I think everybody's really excited about the new characters. They're all lovely. We all got to meet each other. I personally didn't have scenes with anyone new, but they were all up for the task. And it was really great also to, I talked with Little Dill and Kylan, and they were like really excited to be in Atlanta because being in Atlanta is a different experience than being in Los Angeles, right? So they could kind of move like ninjas in Atlanta and they could get together and go places and have fun and build their own relationships as you know, younger cast members. And, you know, I mean, the older cast got together too, don't get me wrong, but I mean, you know, I think one of the things that I think we all pride ourselves on is that if there's a new person, we try to feel make them feel as welcome as possible.
Right.
And we try to let them, you know, to know, hey, we're here, we're available, you know, hang out, let's do this, you know, let's sit together at lunch so nobody feels like they're on the out from day one.
Gotcha.
Because we've all been, you know, just like anybody else, you show up to a job and you don't know anybody, right?
Right.
I mean, that's kind of a tough thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the film world, it can be, you know, you're sitting there and it's you in front of that camera and you need allies in that day to make sure that you're doing, you know, you're doing your job and you know how to get to the cafeteria and all that kind of stuff. So we try to do that for all the new people. And I think you're going to love them all. I hope you love all the new characters.
I think we will. So.
Were you surprised to learn that Derek had a son?
Yeah. Who's the mom?
It's a very good question.
Yeah. Were you guys surprised?
Yes.
Yeah, right? I mean, that would out the gate.
Out the gate.
Wait, there's simmerings back there.
What?
Is there tea back there? Does somebody want to know? Is there a comment? No? Okay, all right.
Betsy left, but she has a fan theory that's just golden.
Oh.
Oh.
She shared it on our episode, yeah.
That's right, yes.
Yes,
and it's great. I come in my mouth, it's so hilarious.
You're the mom!
She's back there.
I love it. I'll be honest. You volunteer as tribute, as they
yes.
say. Yeah, I mean, that was really interesting, and I'm going to throw that to Will. Can you talk about that a little?
No.
Yeah, okay. No. All right.
No.
Would you ever like to see Melissa play grandma to a little teen wolf, or a little baby werewolf?
Wolf,
if you will.
Circle of life. Circle of life. Mm-hmm. You know, fingers crossed that, you know, that we've, you know, when I say we, the collective we have done our jobs to really put something out there that's really special that people tune in for and that we can continue, you know, doing what we love and you guys have something that you love to watch. And so that would be really symbiotic. And, you know, there might be a little wolf on the way. I don't know. Well, I don't know.
Leading into my next question, have you heard any murmurings about possibilities of spinoffs or more movies or anything?
Yeah. I mean, that's the short answer.
Elaborate.
Yeah. You know, yes. I mean, we're all very hopeful. We're all very hopeful that happens. You know, but again, it was just golden to be able to have this opportunity and have people, you know, old faces and new faces come and play in the sandbox again. I always thought that it would be really interesting as I sit here and hop to have an Icon House spinoff.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So imagine this. Okay. Do you guys watch Twilight Zone?
Yeah.
Right. Do you remember that one where, you know, you're in black and then eyes open and there's somebody that's like being operated on? Okay. So it's that. Only it's Melissa opening her eyes.
Oh my God.
What?
And she's in Icon House.
Oh.
And she doesn't know how she got there. Okay. So, because I always thought that would have been an amazing spinoff because there's so many characters, so many stories. And for me, I have always thought, I've spent, much like everybody else, we've all spent time in the hospitals with loved ones, right? Mm-hmm. And you've got those heroes in there, all those doctors, nurses, everybody that's there trying to save lives. What is it like when they wake up in the hospital? That must be a certain level of terrifying if you don't know why you're there.
Right.
So I always thought that would have been, work on it, Will, work on it.
He actually does have some spinoffs. I won't get into it because it's not mine, but one of them does include Melissa.
Oh,
it does.
Let's do it.
Y'all all better be signing up for
sign up.
Paramount Plus the day this movie comes out so that I can then go to Paramount and be like, look at these riches I've given you for large amounts of money that
is
you will pay me.
Is that the pitch?
That's it. Can I think I'll workshop
riches!
It. I'll workshop it. It's a win-win. It's a
give
win-win.
Give us more riches.
Exactly. No, it's a win-win. And
the pitch
I think
it's just like, Teen Wolf equals dollar sign.
Okay.
That's the one page.
Well,
that's a story of emojis.
Hey,
I love it.
That's exactly, there's a story about how James Cameron pitched Aliens to Fox, and he went in to this first pitch, he had a whiteboard, and he wrote Alien up there, and everybody's like, yeah, it was great. Then he wrote an S, Aliens, and they're like, yeah. And then he put a line through the S to make a dollar sign, and they were like, yeah, we got it. Yeah, so there you go. I mean, everybody loves Teen Wolf. I mean, there's enough universe of Teen Wolf to go around. You know, it's like new characters, new creatures, new everything. It's I keep saying this, I've said this to Jeff and Joe, and it's like, why does DC get to have all the fun? Because they're, you know, why do they get, they, you know, they are doing so well with TV, all the shows, you know, from the DC universe. I'm like, what about us? We could have some fun too. So we'll see.
All right. Fingers crossed.
Oh, I want that so much. That'd be great. Okay. So right now we're not sure how Allison returns in the movie, but it has to be a trial for Scott. I mean, there's no way it wouldn't be. So, since Melissa has always been a real compass for Scott, how do you think she'll advise him in this? Because, I mean, at all the times Scott gets knocked down, it's Melissa. Mm-hmm. You know, Scott has a very strong pact. There's always just one person who gives him the best advice. Mm-hmm. So, what do you think?
Good old what's-her-name's back. Okay. That is a line from the first season because I was like, what's her name? So show of hands, how excited are we that Crystal's back? Oh, good. Yeah, we were all very excited. Very, very excited to have her back. And she's very excited as well. I would say, without giving anything away, that I think that the thread of how that mother-son relationship has always been is follow your heart. Mm-hmm. And I believe that is still the advice that is given to this day. And so we'll just have to see how that, you know, pans out. It doesn't always pan out well, you guys, but we shall see.
Excellent. Excellent.
Good.
Were you surprised to learn that Crystal Reed was joining the movie and that, I mean, we don't know exactly what context that's going to be in, but when you learned that news, were you shocked?
Well, the first person that I learned was coming back was actually, and I was really, really happy. And I are close. You know, we both live in Atlanta.
No one knew that.
Nope. Did any of you know that? Way to go, Melissa! Yeah.
Hey, I'm down for everything. So, wasn't that a hilarious joke?
Is that a secret?
I mean,
I don't know what's in
that. Shit.
Oh, wait. Jeff is calling me. I don't know how that happened, so.
Who can keep a secret?
All of our, close the doors, please. All of our best friends in here are definitely not tweeting right now.
I didn't think that was a secret.
I don't know.
I mean, you know, with creative storytelling, there's always going to be touchstones. There's always going to be, there has to be flashbacks. There has to be stuff that brings you to where we are now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, look, there will be old and new faces. That's what I will say. So,
that is accurate.
That is accurate. Yeah. So there's going to be more. So I was really excited to see, like, you know, who and how and why. Who was coming back. And so, yeah, I was really excited. You know, again, another character that, you know, we didn't get to spend that much time together. I think we had maybe one or two scenes through the whole time that, you know, we were filming. And so it was just really great to, sometimes the best times that we have are, you know, in the makeup trailer or at lunch, you know, just kikiing and doing all that good stuff and, you know, catching up on everybody's lives. So, yeah.
We recently talked to Paul Ray of the Teen Wolf Wiki, and he got to see some scenes, and he said at one point he was just looking at the script and saying, "F you, Jeff." How many moments of surprise did you have while reading through the script?
Well, it was, I mean, you know, for me, it's when you're reading something and you're, you know, you're going back in your head to what you have created, and there it is, and there it is, like, you know, personified in a different way. It was never really the, you know, the f*** you of it all. It was always like, oh my gosh, I can't believe they did that, and look what they did there, and how they tied this in. And so that was the surprise for me, is when you're combing through it and you're seeing your own history there. Mm. That was a lot of fun for me. You know, was it fun for you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I was in Indiana. This was months before the announcement there's going to be a movie. I was in Indiana with these two right here for a birthday party, and we were playing a board game, and I had my phone away from me, and I was like, we're taking a break. So I just looked, and there was a missed call from Jeff, and then a text from Jeff. I checked the text, and it said, call me now. And so I ran outside and called him, and he was like, hey, what's going on, man? Where are you? I was like, oh, I'm in Indiana with Kate and Calista. And he goes, okay, great. Don't tell anyone. You can tell them. Don't tell anyone, but there's going to be a movie and all that. And so, I mean, and then I totally thought it was like I'd be able to go on Deadline right then and see it. And then nothing happened for months and months. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, what's happening? And I would text Jeff, and he'd be like, it's up to Paramount when they do all this. But just getting that call was fantastic.
Yeah.
And just being able to work with not as many as you got to work with because you were on set, but just, you know, with Jeff, Joe, and Russell, mm-hmm. and all that it felt like no time passed, honestly, because we were writing in the same offices that we'd written in previously, and so it was just like going back to work.
Yeah,
you know, and it felt like nothing had changed.
Yeah,
you know, we were just like you walk in and there's an empty whiteboard, and you're like, well, we got to fill that up in a certain amount of time,
right.
And if you don't, we're in trouble, and that type of thing. And so it was fantastic. Always. Team Wolf's always fantastic. So.
And you had 100 hours of source material.
Yes, yes. It was fantastic because, like, Jeff was working on another show at the time. He's got Eon Flux happening, so he was with those writers.
Did you know that?
Did y'all know that?
Did you know that?
And so he would...
Thanks for playing.
Yes. He would be with us for a couple hours a day, and we'd work really hard, and then he kind of send us home with homework and mm-hmm. all that. And then it's like, he'd be like, do you remember this thing or that thing? And then it's like, well, I had all the episodes on my computer. So that night I'd go home and I'd have to go through the episodes and find the things he was talking about and then be like, here's the pitch based on what your idea was and all that. Based on, like, how can we make it, you know, relate back to the awesome 100 hours of TV show we have. And because you're right, you know, Old Faces and You in the movie, it was very much like, where have we been?
Right.
And like how to word this correctly.
How do words, people.
How do words? To elevate it, really. I mean, how to take the story.
Exactly.
And then, you know, how do you make it bigger? How do you make it better? How do you make it more shiny?
Right.
Whatever
exactly.
It is. How do you tie it in?
Right.
You know, we have a certain amount of time. We have a certain amount of people. We have a certain amount of, you know, material. How do we make that happen?
Exactly.
Yeah. In a new and different, exciting way.
Right.
But the same.
Exactly. But the same. But different.
I mean, that's I just imagine it, like, the first Avengers movie got so many characters you're just trying to fit into a story, like, without, you know, making it feel overloaded and making sure everyone has their time.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm very excited to see how that plays out.
Well, that was one of the first things we did, because we had a big whiteboard, and then we put a smaller whiteboard next to it. And on the smaller whiteboard, I listed out all the characters from Teen Wolf. And then it was just like, and then Jeff kind of came in and pitched, and was like, who do we need for this story? And then it just started whittling down that list until we got to the final number. And it's just like, 96. These are the characters. What's that?
96
characters, 96 speaking parts. But that's what it was, where it was just like taking, cause we have like, we have an embarrassment of riches of great characters on the show, but then it's like, but not all of them are necessary for every particular story. And it's just figuring out who's best for the story. And then that took time, but, it was fun. It was fantastic.
Cool.
Just
they don't let us in the writer's room.
That is not accurate.
I go in the writer's room all the time.
See? Not accurate. not accurate at all. So, yeah. No, we would bring we brought y'all in at the beginning of seasons and talked about just like,
totally.
What do y'all think? Like, here's Jeff, you know, Jeff would be like, this is what I think we're going to do. It's like, what do you think?
No, I'm just I'm saying physically I would walk in the room every once in a while and you guys would be working. I also adopted a desk in production and it was just this empty desk and it was my desk and everybody then knew that it was my desk. And sometimes we just all need a quiet space and I would go there and pretend like I was a secretary.
It's like, yes, I need a less stressful job. Let's just go to production and deal with that.
Totally.
So on the podcast, we've talked a lot about the women of Beacon Hills, particularly how Melissa McCall is the heart of the show.
Oh,
wow.
It's true.
We all know. Lydia has one of the clearest, most interesting character arcs over the show, in our opinion. Without getting into spoilers, can you tell us anything about how the movie continues to develop these characters?
Yeah, I mean, I think our show writes for women. You know, I mean, I think, it, you know, individually and also as a group. And that's something really wonderful to experience. You know, a lot of times, you know, you don't get that opportunity through a character because, you know, we're a lot of times, and we're all grateful for it as actors, sometimes we're there just to move the story along, and that's important, right? This is going to deviate a little bit, but sometimes, as actors, we're auditioning for one line, right? And you might be like, oh my gosh, just one line. But that one line has gone through 57 edits, right? It's gone through, you know, it's been rewritten. It's gone through editing, you know, all these different hierarchies of people. It's gone through, you know, the studio and everything. It's gone through the budget. So that one line is really important because it does something. It moves the story along. And a lot of times that's the opportunity that we get. And that's the opportunity that we're very grateful for as actors to move the story along. But sometimes you're really part of the story. And I think that that is what everyone has done creatively for each one of these characters, is that we are all part of the story. We're all valid. Our points of view are valid. What we bring to the story character-wise is valid. And that gives, you know, our characters a lot of power individually. And, it, you know, and we all feel very important. And I hope that you guys feel that each character is very important when you watch us, because we try to bring that every day. We try to bring that every day. And, you know, and I was actually talking with Posey, and it was like, we really want to make every day count for this movie. We really want to bring our A game, and we want to show up, and we want to make the best movie that we can. Because again, not everybody gets to do this. And so I think we were all very dedicated each day to show up with our best for women and men, but especially, you know, for the women. Women.
Women are great.
Women are great.
It's awesome.
Can I just say, like, on the subject of maybe only having one line, I started watching The Girl from Plainsville, and I was so annoyed that you were there, but then not saying anything. I was like, why aren't you, like, a lead?
Yeah, so have you guys seen The Girl from Plainville?
Woo!
Woo! Okay, it's a very important story, so if you get to watch it, please do. But that was one of those things, you know, I auditioned. It was two lines. I had to say something really weird about an alligator, and then, like, I was like, watch out for that alligator, we're gonna be late for lunch. And I sent off the audition, and then they came back and they were like, we would like you to be part of this family. You're gonna round out the family. You're gonna be there at certain graduations and certain, you know, lifetime, you know, milestones. And it ended up, you know, I thought, how many episodes could this be? Well, it was 5 episodes. We shot in Savannah.
Nice.
You know, I mean, it was there for many, many days. And so, again, it's just like, it's an amazing job to have, because you never know what's next. Mm-hmm. And you have to be open and willing to do what you think on paper might be something small that actually is really, really grand. I ate a lot of seafood, you guys.
I still need to finish it, but Wilkin, I was like texting him, angry texting, being like, they're underusing Melissa.
I can vouch.
But I mean, it's one of those things, you know, they give you material to do, and sometimes you only have 42 minutes, and so stuff gets cut. And, you know, and the superfluous characters, so to speak, the ones that are just there to kind of represent people and maybe not have that much of the story, you know, we get left behind, but that's okay. Because the checks cash.
There it is.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Yes. There it is. That is the heart of acting.
Cash.
And writing.
Cash.
And everything. Yes.
Cash.
Everything.
Yeah.
That's the world we live in.
But the truth is we do it for free. Just don't tell anybody.
Don't tell a soul.
Don't do it. Don't do it.
You shared a photo of some wedding bands from props on your Insta. Is there going to be a wedding in Beacon Hills?
No, that was just totally random. There's no wedding in Beacon Hills. That was just a photo. That was just a behind the scenes photo that I was taking. They had it on the props table, and I thought that like the sticker was kind of fun or whatever.
Yeah.
Again, trying not to spoil anything, even though I'm sitting here giving you spoilers for some reason. So yeah, no, that was just totally random. And then everybody was like, oh my gosh, is there a wedding? And I'm like, no, liar. You know what I mean? Like, this is a slip up. But no, it was just part of the props, you know? You can only show so much blood.
True. Whenever Will got the script, I was like, okay, now start like doing like keyword searches for like wedding, marriage, proposal.
Yeah, just one of those random
things. I didn't tell her what I found, but I was just like, I'm searching. There's not a wedding.
There's
guys.
Nothing.
No, he told me at the time. There's nothing. I don't know what's happening.
Well,
here.
That's because when I saw the picture, I was just like, what?
Yeah.
And then I went back to the outline that I had. And I was just like, what? And then, but then I was like, hey, Jeff's had this thing for
months. Styles and Derek married? What?
Zing.
There it is.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know why they were there.
There you go. So
we actually have a little bingo card that Kate made up. I'm sure you know most of the answers to these, but.
Oh.
For whenever the film comes out to play along with at home.
Oh, okay. Wait.
So whenever...
I don't know what this is about.
Okay, so like whenever people are... We're going to post it on our site, but like whenever the movie comes out, people can play bingo of like, okay, Derek's life sucks. Go ahead and put it in.
Yeah.
Dead character is not dead. Scott smile lights up a room. People walk in, epic slow-mo.
Okay.
It's Teen Wolf. So, come on.
Some fool underestimates Melissa. Buildings are abandoned. The body count rises. Deaton is mysterious. And the screen is dark and full of creatures.
Yes.
I get it now. Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Sometimes I'm five.
That's okay.
Yeah, we'll post this so anyone that wants to play along whenever they watch the movie. And we'll just see if all of that gets filled in.
It's going to be fun. Do you, spoilers aside, more spoilers aside, do you have a favorite memory from the movie?
Yes, I do. And it happens kind of early, and this very rarely happens. But, you know, because we've worked together for so long, everyone has watched for so long, you know, you hear the characters in your mind, right? And you can hear their cadence, and you can kind of maybe hear their delivery. And there's something that happens very early, and I literally laughed out loud. In dialogue.
Very nice.
I was like, this is a fun moment right here.
Nice.
Yeah. And there's cussing.
There is cussing.
Spoiler alert!
There is cussing.
Someone says the F word.
I know who says it multiple times.
That's fun. That's new.
Well, that was definitely something, because like I remember how it came up, and it was talking, someone was like, can we cuss? And of course Jeff was like, yeah. This is Paramount Plus, baby.
Yeah.
We can do whatever we want.
And so then when you see that in dialogue, then everybody, and forgive me for language if this is bad for everybody, but we're just going to push through on this. So once you know that you can cuss, then everybody wants to cuss. So then everybody is like, let's get to the fucking hospital. You know? What's for fucking lunch? Like everybody, all their characters are trying to get it in, and it's just like, no, that's not going to happen. They're going to cut that out.
It's like the kids have learned a new word.
Yeah.
Once it's learned, there is no...
Totally.
Coming
totally.
Back from that.
Totally.
But yeah, that's just fantastic. So
thank you everybody for being
y'all.
Here.
Thank you.
It's so nice to see your faces. We're gonna have a fun weekend.
It's gonna be a great weekend.
Thanks for being here, you guys. Really. It's gonna be good. Thank you.
All right, Wolfies. We had a great time talking with the always amazing Melissa Ponzio, but over the course of the con, we were able to interview fans and a few other actors, and this is what they had to say.
Calissa, would you like to ask Mr. Lyndon Ashby a question for our podcast?
Ask me. Please do.
You could have your own spinoff movie, and it could be any genre at all as the sheriff. What would it be?
Oh my God. A spinoff movie in Stilinski does what?
Anything you want. It could be any genre. Do you want to be a musical?
Yeah.
I can't see Stilinski in a musical, but maybe he would be. He could definitely do a cooking show.
That'd be awesome.
or I don't know, he'd probably be a cop somewhere, but in a better location.
The beach, investigating a murder, and it's Endless Summer Part 2.
There you go.
Part 3. I forgot there's Part 2. Yes.
Yes, there already is one. Yes.
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 Fantastic.
He surfed his way around the world to solve a crime.
I love it.
Yeah. I love it
I'd
too.
Watch that.
There you go.
Yeah.
Surfing Stilinski.
Oh, yeah. Fantastic. That's a great title.
It is.
We'll have to do a mock up poster for
Yeah, we'll do a mock up poster.
Then I'd have to talk like every actor talks in surf movies. So if you, I don't know, you're a writer, give me a line of dialogue about the ocean. Go ahead.
That's my wave, brah.
So you're supposed to give it like a regular one so you can
check. Oh, I'm sorry. Stop, he's getting away on that surfboard.
Yeah. So that's what you'd say in real life. Stop, he's getting away on the surfboard. But in a surf movie, you go like this. You go, stop, he's getting away on the surfboard. It's like, instead of going, it's a long period swell. It looks like sets of 10 or so, whatever. They go, it's a long period swell. And they get all like philosophical about it. I'm like, just say that. We have these conversations every day and no one like goes all Batman voice.
No. Regular.
Yeah.
No, that'd still be awesome. Surfing Stilinski.
Point Break with Stilinski.
There you go.
Now that would be awesome. Fun action.
Yeah. Well.
Get the surfing and the martial arts.
There you
go. And the cooking.
Yeah, and the cooking, because surfers got to eat.
Exactly, surfers got to eat. So
I don't know, maybe Stilinski like does that thing where he retires and like every cop in the world, he buys a bar.
There you go, yes. Yeah.
And someone from past shows up.
Oh my God, there was an old English series called El Cid, C-I-D.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, no.
Ian Bowen just walked in with a bell. I don't know what's happening here.
Oh, no. Classe Azul.
Classe.
That's a good... Do you like tequila?
Sure.
You'll like that.
If we're doing shots.
Pretty damn tasty.
Nice.
If you don't shoot that, you just sip it.
Oh, sipping tequila.
Yeah.
Got it. Very nice.
But it was about two cops who retired, partners. They move. They buy a bar and a boat. You know, like they're like every cop's dream. And they move to this island or whatever, and they don't realize that it's one of the only places in the world that doesn't have an extradition treaty with Great Britain.
Nice.
And so every criminal in Great Britain is there, find out they used to be cops, they burn their boat, they sink the boat and burn the bar in the first episode.
Nice.
I love that premise.
Nice. That's fantastic.
How have I never heard of it?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Because I remember when Cheers, the owner of the bar in Cheers, was he an old cop?
Sam Malone?
No.
Oh, the old guy.
The old guy who's like in the first season
and then he died.
Show.
He died.
Like, oh, I did not know that.
Died.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And then Sam took over. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if he was an ex-cop.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't know, but that's what it'd be. Surfing Stilinski, who owns a bar in a tropical location and a boat.
Okay, I would totally watch
a bar and a boat. Goes fishing and catching criminals.
Fantastic.
And drinking.
Yeah.
We're going to do some drinking, some criminal catching, and some fishing.
Sounds good to me.
Yep.
Thank you very much, Lyndon, for answering that question.
You're very welcome.
All right, folks. I'm at Howler Con with Mads, and what we want to know is, what are you most excited for in the new movie?
Seeing more of Deputy Parrish, because Ryan Kelly is my fave.
Wow. I love that. Elaborate, please.
What do you mean? Like, just more of him? Like, I mean, listen, I just want more Parrish. I want to know more about Parrish. I'm hoping they'll expand on him a little.
Nice.
I hope to get to see him fight a bit more with the team itself. Like, we've seen a lot of him just doing stuff off on the side with the sheriff.
Nice.
I want to see him more with the pack.
Okay. Well, having worked on the script for the movie, I think you might enjoy some things in the movie. So we'll have to just see how all that plays out. So, and all that. Also, could you give us a suggestion for a what if episode? On our podcast, we like to do bonus episodes where we just do what if. What if Styles got the bite? What if Victoria had lived? Like, what would have happened if we just made one small change? What do you think would be an interesting single change that would shake the foundations of Teen Wolf?
So one of my headcanons, headcanons was when Jordan first came on, that he was Isaac's older brother.
I've heard that before.
Been so cool to see that like actually be a thing, because that would have been like, oh, more family, you
exactly.
know?
Exactly.
But another one that I really would have liked to have seen was, so I also think it would have been interesting if Stiles had came back from the hunt mm-hmm. without his own memories.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah. like he had amnesia. He didn't know who he was, which is the reverse of what happened to his friends.
Exactly.
So like, I think that would have been a cool thing to explore.
No, that would have been a lot of fun where everyone kind of goes through the, what the hell is a Stiles and then getting it all back. And then he returns and he's like, what? Who is this?
And he doesn't know anybody.
Yeah.
And Scott's like acting like he's his best bud. And it's like, but we don't know you. I don't
exactly.
know you, you know.
Yeah.
So.
No, that would be, there would be fantastic drama because it's like, I guess that kind of delves into like how much our personality is kind of, not dictated, but massaged mm-hmm. by context.
Yes.
You know, that it's the context of growing up in a certain place with certain people mm-hmm. kind of influences who you are and your personality.
Right.
So if you strip all that out, you're still you, but it's
but
like
there's
this...
that extra pressure of feeling like you have to perform, like you have to be that person that everyone thinks you are, but you're like, I don't know that person, so I'm going to be the person I am now.
Right, exactly.
And like, I've actually thought, I'm a writer, so I've thought this out, and
fantastic.
I've thought about like writing this out and being like, and he has this issue of all these people that know him, and so he like runs away from Beacon Hills and
yeah.
he's like, I need to back away. I need
yeah.
space. I need to figure out who I am. I need to figure out where my memories went, if I can ever get them back,
of
you
course.
Know, so.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Well, if you ever write it, we would love to read it. So.
Oh, well, definitely. I mean, I'll hit you up.
Fantastic. We look forward to it. Thank you very much for talking with us.
Yeah, of course. It was so great to see you guys here at the con.
Wonderful to see you too.
All right. Thank you so much.
All right, folks. We are at Howler Con with the one and only Deputy Parrish, Ryan. And we want to know if your character could have a spinoff movie, not necessarily horror. Yeah. What kind of genre would your spinoff movie be?
Well, I'd like it to be action, you know, he's like a,
oh, yeah.
He's mm-hmm. a spinoff would be something law enforcement, right? So
yeah.
maybe he's a private eye
Very
or
cool.
like a detective, in action.
Nice.
I think that makes sense with Parrish.
Good action. Who would be the director of this then for a good action film with Parrish, the Hellhound?
Well, I mean, are we going anyone?
Yeah, anyone.
Well, I'm going to exclude any Teen Wolf. Director to not hurt any feelings, right?
Okay.
You got to go big. You got to go Michael Bay. You got to just explosions. Things
there you
just
go. Very nice.
Insane. Just buildings crashing for no reason. They're like, wait, what? That's Paris? I'm like, I don't care. It'll be massive.
Nice. And it'll be pretty because
yeah.
he shoots pretty films.
Yes.
So excellent.
And I like his budgets.
They are yeah, massive.
I think I'd get a good payday if that was his.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Have you seen Ambulance?
No.
It's supposed to be actually good.
Yeah?
Yeah, like the story is supposed to be, because he's got the spectacle and all that, but sometimes
yes.
the story and characters may be a little lacking
yes. Yes.
and all that, but a lot of people are saying that Jake Gyllenhaal and, oh my god, the actor from Watchmen, I can't remember his name all of a sudden. Yeah, you gotta watch Watchmen.
Yeah.
But it's supposed to be fantastic and super
okay.
good, so all right. So
it's gonna be on my radar.
Very nice. All right, guys, it's gonna be a Michael Bay Parrish film as a private eye and buildings fall down for no reason. So
yes,
there we go.
Explosions.
Awesome.
Nonstop carnage.
Awesome.
Police chases on highways, bridges collapsing. I want it all.
Nice.
Basically Transformers but Parrish.
Transformers but Parrish. You heard it here, folks. So I'm at Howler Con with Jenna, and I want to ask her, what is the one thing you're most excited about for the new movie?
That would be to see how exactly Allison is going to come back.
Okay, interesting, interesting. Do you have any theories of your own?
I'm not too sure. Maybe, you know, one that I've always thought someone could have bitten her just before she got turned, or the fact that Scott tried to, like, save
yep.
her.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he did something
yep.
that we didn't see and it didn't take,
mm-hmm.
so he thought she died and... She's, you know, just been out there all along.
That's true. She wouldn't be the first Argent who we thought died and who showed up later as another creature. So interesting, interesting. Okay. Well, speaking of what ifs, we like to, on the podcast, do bonus episodes where we just ask a question. You know, like, what if Stiles got the bite instead of Scott? Or what if Victoria didn't die? So, what could be one change that would alter the foundations of Teen Wolf that you might be interested in hearing about?
I think it would be, what if Kate was raised by her mother or just wasn't raised by Gerard? Because I feel like a lot of... the things that Kate has done has been through influence from Gerard, and
yes.
if Gerard wasn't influencing her, then, you know, practically nothing that's happened could have happened.
That's very true. We never really delved into Mama Argent. So that would be interesting to know, like, what Gerard's wife was like. And maybe she was softer, or maybe she was like Victoria. Who knows? You know, so, but that would be very interesting. So awesome. Well, that's a great idea. Thank you. Thank you, Jennifer, giving us that suggestion and for talking to us and for meeting us here at Howler Con. And I hope you have a great rest of your convention.
You too.
Awesome. Thank you very much. We're at Howler Con. Cliss and I are at Howler Con, and we are talking to Hillary and Leilani, and we want to know, what are y'all most looking forward to in the new movie?
I'm very interested to see the thing that Melissa was, I guess, not supposed to say, but she did. So that, now that it's been said, I'm like, okay, wait. So, like, I assume there's got to be, like, a scene or something. Like, right? So that has got to be, or, like, a type of thing. So right now, that's what I've been thinking about.
Interesting.
That's
interesting.
Oh, also, obviously, Derek and Kid.
Yep.
Like, so those, all the family stuff, I guess.
Nice. Fantastic.
That's what I'm thinking of right now.
All
right.
What about you, Healer?
Yeah, pretty much along similar lines. I'm really looking forward to seeing how they bring Allison back. You know, she's been dead for so long. I just don't know how that's going to work. I'm also really interested in knowing Eli's parentage, but I guess we'll see what the movie comes out.
Yeah.
But yeah, those would probably be my two bigger questions for the movie.
Very nice. Fantastic. Well, those are fantastic answers, and I guess we'll all have to wait till fall to get those answers and see what's going to happen. All right. Thank you all. We are at Howler Con with Mr. Ian Nelson, and we want to know, if young Derek had a spinoff movie, what genre would you like to choose? It doesn't have to be horror, but is there another genre you'd like to see, another type of genre you'd like to see young Derek in?
Well, you know that young Derek was supposed to have a spinoff. Did you know that?
Elaborate.
See, now we're dropping bombs on the plot. So when I was hired for Teen Wolf, it was a backdoor pilot. My 308 was a backdoor pilot for a spinoff Derek show, and it never happened.
Oh, man.
But I think it would have been same tonally as Teen Wolf.
Right.
Probably slightly different. I don't know how it would have differed.
Right.
It was... So that was interesting. So technically, your question is rooted in more truth than theoretics.
All right.
So what tone would it be? Well, if we're looking back when I was playing young Derek, I feel like the tone of that show would probably be a little more like... I feel like there'd be more innocence to it.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like there'd be a little more innocence. I feel like it would probably more like... Maybe this is just my own desires, but it would center more close to like a High School Musical vibe.
Very cool.
Yeah, because it's like, you know, Derek was cool to play basketball, you know, like Troy.
You were a very talented musician with that triangle. So,
well, I wasn't making music when I played Teen Wolf, clearly, because the only instrument they gave me was the triangle. But I was not making music back then.
So, okay, well, when did that happen? When did you pick up the guitar? And how did that come about?
Well, I made my first song. We finished my first song, 21st Century Love, about 2 weeks before we went into lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
But that was my first song. So I really just did music over the pandemic.
Wow.
It's like...
That, yes.
You. So it's been an interesting journey with music, but I essentially just committed myself to playing guitar a ton and writing a bunch of songs last year, and made 3 music videos and put out 3 songs. And then when the quarantine lifted, I started going around LA with my band. And then about 2-3 months ago, I started doing a bunch of solo acoustic shows in LA.
Nice.
Just like trying to get that under my belt. So that came in handy last night.
Yes, yes.
Even just understanding how to set stuff up and, like, you know, these are all things you have to learn.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. And
so, yeah, that's my journey with music. It's been, like, most recently over the past 2 years.
That's fantastic, man. It's so cool that you were able to take... That's so cool that you're able to take the terrible pandemic and just being locked in a place, you know, and then just... broadening your horizons with it. I mean, that's fantastic. I did not do anything like that, unfortunately.
I started a podcast.
I'm sorry. I started a very popular podcast with 2 of my best friends who I met on Teen Wolf. So, but that's so interesting. So
Had you ever dabbled in guitar or any kind of music?
I owned a guitar.
Okay.
I owned a guitar that I bought myself as a present for booking a role in a movie called The Judge.
Nice.
I bought this kind of like not very nice guitar for myself. And I had it laying around for years, but I didn't actually try learning like how to play
right.
really until I started making music.
Nice.
Because I realized I had to get better as a guitar if I wanted to write songs.
Right.
So I started practicing, I'd say like two and a half years ago, like really started to try to learn the instrument.
Excellent.
So
that's
still pretty new to me, but.
You're doing fantastic, man. Again, last night's show was a lot of fun, and all the songs are great. So, I mean, well, good luck with all that, and thank you for talking with us. We greatly appreciate it. So,
my pleasure.
All right, man. We have a great rest of your con, and we look forward to seeing everything else you do.
Thank you very much. Who are you the assistant to? What writer?
Oh, I was the writer assistant for all the for everybody, and then I wrote five episodes by the end of it. Yeah, thank you very much. It was greatest thing that ever happened to me, other than meeting my two best friends on Teen Wolf.
It's Calissa.
I'm so sorry. And our, unfortunately, our third co-host, Kate, who they've been best friends forever, and who I met both of them on Teen Wolf, she tested positive for COVID the day before we were all supposed to get on a plane. And not ideal. But we've been keeping her updated and all that, and just trying to make her feel a part of it. But I don't know, we'll all get out to another one, and it'll be fantastic. So yeah, but all right. Well, thank you very much for talking, and we'll see you around for the rest of the day. All right, man. No, thank you very much, man. Yeah, nice to meet you too. All right, folks. I am at Howler Con with Gabby with 1B, and what we want to know is, what are you most excited about for the new Teen Wolf movie?
To see how Allison comes back. She's one of my favorite characters, and when I heard that she was coming back, I was extremely, extremely excited.
Very nice.
So I'm really excited to see her back.
Do you have any theories on how it could be happening?
I have one.
Ooh.
But I'm like debating on it. It's the drag doctors brought her back, mm-hmm. even though they're dead.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, you never know. You know,
it's you never know. Doctors. You never know.
They're unexpected, and yeah.
Can I let you in on a little secret?
Yeah.
When we were breaking season 5, there's always that tube with the body in it.
Yeah.
And at one point, we're like, well, that's like Chekhov's body. We gotta do something with the body. And for a hot minute, we were like, what if it's Allison? What if they pull out this body and put it on a table, clean it off, and then it's Allison? Sadly, we didn't go down that road very far because we already had some other ideas that we were thinking, because, you know, like 5A leads into 5B. So we kind of knew where we were going in the second half of that season. And we're like, okay, well, this won't work. But for about 5 minutes, we're like, what if that's what it was? And it was a lot of fun for a few minutes, but sadly we didn't go that way. Speaking of what ifs, on our podcast we do bonus episode where we do what ifs, and we just ask a question like, what if Victoria didn't die? Or, you know, what if Styles got the bite? Something like that, where it's one change but affects the entire show. What do you think would be an interesting what if episode? What's one change that could have been made that would have just drastically altered the foundation of the show?
Ooh. I've always had, because I write a lot of fan fiction.
Wonderful.
And one thing I always write about, and like I always try to put in my stories, is what if Scott had like a secret sibling?
Oh.
Or what if Styles was secretly Scott's brother?
Nice.
And what's another one? It's a lot.
No.
I just met Tyler Hoechlin, and I'm like,
I get it completely. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
I totally understand.
What's another one? Oh, what if Melissa?
Mm-hmm.
What if Melissa was secretly a hunter, but she didn't want to tell Scott?
Ooh, that's interesting. Maybe she was a hunter, but then when he got bit, that kind of threw a wrench into her works, because it's like, oh, now I got to hunt my baby and all that. That's fun. I like that idea a lot. I could see that happen.
Yeah.
I could see that happen.
Yeah. Teen Wolf. Anything
exactly.
can happen.
No, it is Teen Wolf and anything can happen. So awesome. Well, thank you very much, Gabby with 1B, for talking to us. And I hope you have a great rest of your con, okay?
You too.
Excellent.
Thank you for everything.
Yes.
All right, folks. We are at Howler Con in New Jersey with Mr. Ian Bowen. And do you want to ask the question?
Sure.
Yes, we have a question.
Yes.
She's like, I didn't even prepare. No.
Oh, we're prepared.
So the question is, what do you think would have happened if Peter had won in the first season?
If he hadn't been killed and he had remained the alpha, I think he would have devolved into a super maniacal villain past the point of revenge, and he would have just, like, blossomed deeper into his... psychopathy is a, and tried to sort of install himself as the king of the world. Yeah. And then, you know, you just don't know any bounds at that point. So thank goodness he didn't. And now he's got a long road to hoe to try to get back to where he was.
Yeah. That makes complete sense.
I like that answer a lot.
I like that answer a lot too. Sense. That's fantastic. How has Howler Con been treating you?
Final one. These are fantastic. Mm-hmm. Everybody's got such a great attitude. And it's nice to see so many faces that you've seen for so many years, especially to get back to even doing them
right
after the virus. So this is only the second one I've done since I think it started.
Nice.
And it's, you know, you see a lot of the same people. So you get big hugs, take really great pictures, and we just, you know, have a ball.
Nice. I've watched some of Yellowstone, but I'm not familiar with, like, its fandom. Does it do conventions, stuff like that? Is
they're
it
just,
that type of show?
Yeah, they're just testing the waters because people do... they are really fanatical about it, but it doesn't necessarily cross over into where they would want to do convention stuff.
Gotcha.
Necessarily, but there's a little bit.
Excellent.
Yes, it's just fun to celebrate with anybody that really likes the show and wants to just talk about it. So
absolutely.
For us, we're like, yeah, that's great.
Absolutely.
And that's really all of the stuff.
I actually worked on The Toe. Are you going to be doing any other projects like that?
The Toe was supposed to be like the seed of who that person was, and then I wanted to show what his life is and how did he get there, because there's so much that happens in such a small space, and at the end you're like, holy shit. So I haven't done it yet. I'm a little bit lazy, but I did a lot of work on it, and I'm not sure what it's going to be yet. JR and I are more spending our time talking to Peter Argent than that. But you never know.
Yeah. Is directing kind of like, is that in the distance?
Yes, absolutely.
Fantastic.
Yeah, directing that was one of my favorite days I've ever had on any set.
Awesome.
And I just enjoy. I mean, I still love working as an actor. And
of course,
I'm not going to quit. But when you get to tell the story and show you it, it's just a different satisfaction.
Fantastic.
I like it a lot. So nowadays, you have to write it to get to direct it.
Fantastic.
And so you can build whatever you want.
That's awesome.
3D art. Yeah, I love it.
That's fantastic. Awesome. Well,
very cool.
Yeah.
Thanks,
well,
guys.
Thank you very much for talking to us. We appreciate it.
Anytime.
That concludes this week's episode of Return to Beacon Hills and our experience at Howler Con 2022. We hope you had as much fun listening as we did talking about all things Teen Wolf. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at RTBH Podcast and Tumblr and TikTok at Return to Beacon Hills. If you'd like to ask us questions or offer suggestions for future topics to discuss, you can email us at returntobeaconhills@gmail.com. Rate and review us on iTunes or wherever you get your podcast goodness. 5-star reviews get a shout out. Have a great week, and we'll see you again soon on Return to Beacon Hills.
Dude, it's Beacon Hills.